In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. Christos Anesti, Christ is risen. I think the most forgettable or the most forgotten person in telling the story of the resurrection is the person of the Father himself. We used to speak about the resurrection, about the persons who are visible to us in the story of the resurrection. That's good. But to forget the invisible person, the Heavenly Father himself, who is behind the whole story and who is the reason of the whole story, because the whole story was planned by him for his glory. So to forget him is something need to be revisited and need to rethink about it and to keep him in our minds. The case with the apostles was not like this. The apostles, after the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, when they spoke about the story of the resurrection, they had in mind the person of the Father, and they spoke about him repeatedly. Many times they spoke about him after the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. I give you a few examples. In the synagogue in Antioch, in the book of Acts, chapter 13, we hear in the book of Acts, chapter 13, when St. Peter was addressing the congregation in the synagogue of Antioch, in Acts chapter 13, verse 30, he said, God raised him from the dead. God raised him from the dead. So it's very easy to understand or to figure it out that he was talking about the Father, that the Father raised Christ, who was dead in his flesh. So he was talking about Christ in his body, in his flesh, in the tomb for 3 days, but the Father, God the Father, raised him from the dead. And he was seen for many days by those who came up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are his witnesses to the people. So he spoke about how the people killed our Lord Jesus Christ in the flesh, and how God raised him, and how he was visible to the witnesses who witnessed to him to the people. Also, in the house of Cornelius, in Acts chapter 10, we can see the same thing when St. Peter said about the Lord Jesus Christ that they killed him by hanging on a tree. And then he said in Acts 10, verse 40, God raised him up on the third day and showed him openly. So even the appearances of our Lord Jesus Christ in the flesh, St. Peter attributed to the Father. So he said, him God raised up on the third day. So Jesus was raised by his Father on the third day. And then he said that he showed him openly. It means that the Father showed him or made him appear openly to his witnesses. And we find a strong evidence for the same thought written by St. Paul in Ephesians 1. He was praying to the people of the Ephesian church that God may enlighten their minds and they may give them the wisdom of the revelation and the knowledge of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. And he said, I'm praying to you, praying for you to be having this understanding or enlightenment to know. And then he said in Ephesians 1, verse 19, to know what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places. So he was telling them that Christ was dead, he was killed, but I wish that you, the Ephesians, and everybody to know the exceeding greatness of God's power toward us. It is for us, according to the work of his mighty power, which he, the Father, worked in Christ, and he, the Father, raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places. So this is what I would like to attract your attention, that behind the whole story of the resurrection, there is the invisible Father who planned and who did everything by his mighty power in the person, our Lord Jesus Christ, while being in the flesh. And to understand this very well, I want you to put in your mind something, that Christ is the eternal Logos of God, and he had his glory before the creation of the world. But what happened, that Christ emptied himself, and he was incarnated and became man. And this emptiness, or this period of emptiness, extended to the time of his crucifixion and his death and his burial in the tomb. And then he became another phase in his life on earth to go back to the glory when God the Father raised him from the dead. So nothing is confusing you about that, because all these verses are talking about Christ while being incarnated in his human nature on earth. But look how amazing is the power of the Father, or how amazing the great works he has done in the story of the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. First of all, the Father declared mightily and powerfully that Jesus is his Son. For sure you remember that after his baptism in the River Jordan, the Father says, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And on the mountain of the Transfiguration, it happened again, the Father said, a voice came from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And you remember very well the challenge of the high priest and the Pharisees while seeing Christ on the cross. They challenged him, saying, if you are the Son of God, save yourself, come down from the cross. But in the plan of the Heavenly Father, he decided to proclaim He decided to proclaim Christ as his son by his resurrection from the dead. This is not my explanation or my meditation. This is what exactly what St. Paul said in Romans 1, in verses 3 and 4. He spoke about Christ saying that Christ was born of the seed of David according to the flesh. So when we speak about his humanity, we know that he is of the descendant of David. But when we speak about his divinity, this is something else. And then in verse 4 said, and declared, Christ was declared to be the Son of God with power, according to the spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead. So the evidence that Christ is the Son of God is the resurrection. The resurrection, the most powerfully evident, has been declared in the New Testament about Christ being the Son of God is his resurrection. Yes, there are many stories, many miracles, and many teachings of our Lord Jesus Christ telling us that he is the Son of God, and many believed in him that he is the Son of God. But for St. Paul, he said that he was declared powerfully or strongly to be the Son of God by the resurrection from the dead. So this is the first thing happened to Christ by his Father in his resurrection. The first thing that we can mention is that he was declared to be the Son of God by the resurrection. The Father also did something else for his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, that he loosed him from all the pains of death. And there are many Psalms talking about this, Psalm 116, and also another Psalm, Psalm 16, which are called of the Messianic Psalms and speaks about the death and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. St. Paul quoted Psalm 16 in the day of the Pentecost to speak about Christ, about his death, about his resurrection, and he explained powerfully that the Jesus of Nazareth, God raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should held by death. And then he referred to what David said, for you will not leave my soul in Hades, nor you will allow your Holy One to see corruption. So when St. Paul prayed to the Ephesians to understand the exceedingly powerful power of God in Jesus Christ revealed in the resurrection, one of these aspects of this powerful work was freeing our Lord Jesus Christ from the pains of death. And something also amazing happened by the Father to his Son, that when he raised his Son, he raised him for eternity. He is no longer going to be dead. And this also mentioned by St. Peter in Acts 13. In verse 34, he said, he raised him from the dead, no more to return to corruption. No more to return to corruption. He whom God raised up saw no corruption. So all the people who were raised from the dead, like the girl of Jairus or the son of Nain, the widow of Nain, or Lazarus. All of them were raised from the dead, but went to death again. But for Christ, he was raised by the Father himself, and he will no longer go back to death. And Sambor mentions this. He said that we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. Christ will not die again. And he said in the Hebrews that because he continues forever, he has unchangeable priesthood, so he continues forever. And in Hebrews 7:25, he said, he always lives to make intercession for them. So we are serving and worshiping the Son of God. We are worshiping the one who is living forever, who is living forever, who is living before the Father, interceding for us forever. And as I mentioned before, that the resurrection were the first step for Christ to go back to the glory, to his glory was the Father who was prepared before the foundation of the earth. Christ himself prayed for that. In John 17, verses 4 and 5, he said to the Father, I have glorified you on the earth. I have finished the work which you have given to me to do. And now, O Father, glorify me together with yourself, with the glory which I had with you before the world was. So the resurrection was the first milestone in the journey of Christ toward the glory he had before the foundation of the earth. And Christ had this always in his mind, that he is going to the Father. Even when he met Mary Magdalene, he told her, I am ascending to my Father, and tell my brethren that I am going to my Father who is your Father, and to my God who is your God. So he had always, while being in flesh, he had always this thought in his mind that he is going back to his Father to receive the glory, his glory, which was prepared for him, which was for him before the foundation of the world. And the apostles, after his resurrection, spoke very well and powerfully about Christ entering his glory after his resurrection. We hear in the book of Acts, chapter 5, St. Peter speaks to the chief priest, the God of our father raised up Jesus, whom you murdered by hanging on a tree. Him God has exalted to his right hand to be prince and savior, to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. So St. Peter here was witnessing to the glory that Christ received from the Father after his resurrection, when the Father raised him up and seated him on his right hand. He said, God of our Father raised up Jesus, whom you murdered by hanging on a tree. Him God has exalted, God has exalted Jesus to his right hand to be, listen to this, to be prince and savior, and to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And this is what I quoted before, also what I quoted before in Ephesians 1. speaks more strongly and powerfully about the glory that Christ received after his resurrection. In Ephesians 1, verse 19, he said, "What is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principalities, all principality and power and might and dominion." Now Christ, after his resurrection, he is far above all principality and power and might and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. So forever, for eternity, Christ is far above everything. And he put all things under his feet. The Father put everything under the feet of Christ and gave him to be head over all things to the church. Now Christ is the head of the church. And also in Philippians 2, there is an amazing verse that speaks about Christ in his emptiness, himself of the glory, and his going back to his glory by the power of his Father. St. Paul in Philippians 2, in verse 7, he said, "He made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bond servant, and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even to the death of the cross." So this is the phase, or this is the stage of his humility, or in his emptiness, when he emptied himself. And then in verse 9, he speaks about going back to the glory of his Father. He says, "Therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of those in heaven and of those on earth and of those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." And I would like to conclude with this today, that all the story, all the plan of the coming of the eternal Logos of God, of the Son of God to the earth, all this plan, including his humbling himself and emptying himself and going back to his glory in heaven, all this story is to the glory of God the Father, as St. Paul said in Philippians 2:11. But St. Paul speaks about all of this, and he said that this is for us. This is for us. Yes, this will end to the glory of God the Father, but this is for us, as this will make us think about what our share in the resurrection, and I hope God will give us a chance to speak about this in later time. Glory be to God forever and ever. Amen.